making a very specific claim about him.
That's right, that he is equal to the Father in divine power, that he has the very same nature as the Father. He's not just a guru, he's not just an enlightened one, or or God in the sense that we're all God, right? This sort of monism view, right? Where everything is God.
Yeah.
Right? And no, Jesus is God in a very distinct way, coming from that Jewish culture that he claimed to be equal to the Jewish God, the one infinite creator of all things that exist besides himself, right?
Yeah.
And claiming to be equal to Almighty God. And that's what got him killed. I mean, he went to the cross for it. But that wasn't the end of the story.
No.
Fundamentally, the reason why we believe he's Emmanuel was because there is another part to that story, namely his resurrection, that he still lives to this day.
I just want to say, for those who are joining us on video right now, the reason you see three of us in the shot is Russell from EWTN is here.
That's right.
With his super expensive video camera, which is capable, through some kind of special effects, of making Carlo and I look good, we're told. I don't know. And this is part of a shared promotional stuff that we're doing with EWTN.
And I think, what do they call these shots? They call it B-roll? Is that what
B-roll? Is this B-roll?
B-roll.
What's A-roll?
I don't know.
Because I'm giving it my best here. Why is this B-roll?
We're not the A-team, man.
A-roll is what? When you're doing the actual interviews with us?
Okay. Oh, wow. Right. Good job, son.
Yeah, so we'll shoot A-roll tomorrow.
We learned something new.
Yeah.
Now, right. I'm sure Brandon already knew
that. Well, I'm not
going
to try as hard then. I was putting effort in to looking good and sounding good. I'm just gonna let my hair down now. Because
if I could put effort into looking better, I'd be one good looking dude, man. But that just doesn't work, Si.
I don't think.
No matter how much effort I put into it, I can't become that
looking
good looking.
Looking better is even possible for you, Carlo. I think you may.
Well, there is a possibility of looking better, and it's embedded in you.
I think I'm gonna tear up a little bit right now.
Oh, get your tissue, man.
Oh gosh, that's beautiful, Carlo. I think we're getting B-roll in my ear right now. It's very uncomfortable. But
looking over your shoulder.
Oh, maybe there's sound though. Like, is there sound on this B-roll? Do you know? Oh, okay. So, Carlo, transubstantiation. I'm just saying that to try to let him get a good B-roll. Where did he go? Oh,
10 seconds of silence. Oh. Still silence.
So we have to go silent while we make that connection with you.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. So happy to have you here with us today. I am Si Killett, your host, and this Jesus guy, who is he? He himself at one point asked his own apostles, who do people say that I am? And then who do you say that I am? And maybe one of the central questions that we can face in life is, who do we say that he is, this Jesus? He is given the title Emmanuel. That title has a significant meaning that we'll talk about in a moment. But others just call him a prophet or a nice guy or maybe even a crazy person or a rabbi. Or he has many other ways that he is described, many true, but the fullness of truth about him is the most important thing to get at, and that's what we will try to do today with our guest, Carlo Broussard, as we ask, Jesus, Emmanuel, or mere prophet? Carlo, thanks for being with us.
You're welcome, Si. Thanks for having me, brother.
Carlo, as you know, is an apologist here at Catholic Answers, one of the hardest working men in apologetics, and he has a brand new book, Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel, and the Church. And today, I guess we're in the gospel part, because that is who Jesus is central to the gospel.
Amen to that. He's the one who brought the good news. The gospel for Christians is the good news about Jesus. So that's what we want to talk about today, the good news about Jesus. Who he was, who was he? Is he merely a prophet, just a wise teacher? Or is he equal to the Father, as we say he claimed to be? And what's the evidence for that? And if he even did claim to be equal to the Father,
it doesn't
follow from that that we ought to automatically believe him, right? So we have to apply some test, some reasonable criteria that would justify our belief in the claim. So why should we believe the claim even if he did make such a claim to be divine, to be equal to God the Father? And ultimately, the answer to that question boils down to the greatest miracle that he performed, namely his resurrection. For without his resurrection, if he remained in that tomb, then everything he said about himself and being God would just be futile. It'd be a moot point. Who cares? He was just a crazy man, and there's no reason to believe those claims because he was killed and put in the tomb, and that's it. End of story. But the story didn't end because he rose from the dead, which vindicates everything he said about himself. So looking at the evidence that he did indeed claim to be God and why we can trust that evidence, and then asking the question, why should we believe the claim? Because maybe he was lying, maybe he was a lunatic. But we have good reason to reject those alternative explanations, and even the alternative explanation that, well, maybe he was claiming to be God like a guru, like an enlightened one, in the sense that we're all gods. No, he was a Jewish man, right, coming from a Jewish theological tradition.
Right.
So when he talked about God, he talked about the infinite reality, the uncreated creator, the creator of all things that exist outside of himself. And he claimed to be that very entity, that very reality. And he vindicated those claims, not only by the miracles he performed in his earthly ministry, which can be historically verified as well, and there's good evidence to accept those narratives as historically reliable, but also ultimately his resurrection. Because if Jesus rose from the dead, man, then Christianity's true, and everything that goes with it.
And that's why it's so important, the early church, that the constantly repeating the phrase, he is risen. The Lord is risen. 888-318-7884 is our number, 888-31-TRUTH. If maybe you're a non-Christian and you don't believe that Jesus is God and you'd like to share with us why you don't believe he's God and engage in a conversation about that, 888-318-7884 is the number for you as well. Maybe you're just inquiring about Christianity, curious about what Christians teach about Jesus as God. Maybe, in fact, you are already a Christian and you need some clarification about what we're talking about when we're talking about the divinity of Jesus. Carlo is here to take all of those questions and anything else you might want to know having to do with the question about the identity of Jesus. Who is this? 888-318-7884 for those of you watching on the video stream. You will notice there are people in the studio with us today.
Right.
They are from EWTN, our second most important partner, as I like to say, in the whole world. They're here to shoot some video. We're going to be doing some promotion together, and they're getting that promotional video today while Carlo and I are here in the studio. And the reason I say that they are our second most important partner, because our most important partner goes by the name Emmanuel.
Amen. And why do we have that relationship? That's what we want to talk about on today's show.
888-318-7884 is the number. Carlo, so this would be in your book, your book where you basically anticipate the objections that people, the obstacles that people might face in believing in God and believing that the Catholic Church is the church, the true church of Christ. This is a particular obstacle that I think modern people struggle with most. I mean, it's very, very difficult for the modern person to think, well, why would any one man, how could I believe that his claim that he's God?
Right. Well, this gets back to what we were talking about at the outset of the show, namely the fundamental reason why we should believe Jesus' claims to be God is that he rose from the dead. And there's good historical evidence for that. So, you know, Dr. William Lane Craig, he's a prominent Protestant apologist, and he's done some amazing work in defending the historicity of the resurrection of Jesus Christ to where we can conclude, you know, with historical certainty, that it is a historical fact that Jesus rose from the dead. And the way that process works is we look at certain circumstantial details in the New Testament, certain details surrounding Jesus' death, that he was buried, right? So he died, he was buried, and that the early Christians claimed to have seen him 3 days after he was put in a tomb. And you have this unique early Christian development that the Christians kept going forward proclaiming Jesus to be Lord and God. I mean, why in the world would you keep claiming somebody to be God when they were killed by the very enemy you were hoping he would deliver you from,
right,
and put him in a tomb? So that's very interesting that they would continue forward professing him to be Lord, God, Messiah, bow down, worship him, be saved by him, rather than going find some other master. So all of these historical details, right, we have to look at the various explanations. What's the best explanation of these historical details, these historical facts? And then, of course, each of those facts, we reason through the evidence to come to the conclusion that these facts are historically reliable as well, as the New Testament records them. And then ultimately, when you look at the explanations, the only explanation that explains all of the facts in the best way, and all of the others fail to some degree, is what the early Christians said, that Jesus physically rose from the dead in a glorious and transformed way. And so we look at the historicity of those claims. Jesus died, he was buried, the alleged appearances, these are all historically reliable. It doesn't make sense that they were lying about it, right? That doesn't explain the fact that they died for this message. The fact that they died for the message proves their sincerity, so that undermines the conspiracy theory. It doesn't make sense that they hallucinated, because that fails to explain the historical fact of the empty tomb, and various other naturalistic explanations to try to get out of the straitjacket of Jesus' literal resurrection, right? But we see that these alternative naturalistic explanations fail, and the one that remains standing is the explanation that he physically rose from the dead in a glorified and transformed way, which explains all of those historical details.
888-318-7884 is our number. Carlo Broussard is our guest, and we're talking about Jesus. Is he Emmanuel, or is he a mere prophet? If you'd like to join us with your questions for Carlo from any perspective, whether you are believer or unbeliever or not sure whether you believe or not, 888-318-7884. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hey everyone, Carlo Broussard here. Are you looking for an on-fire Catholic speaker to come and speak at your conference or parish event? If so, you're in luck. We've got a host of Catholic Answers speakers, including myself, just waiting to get on a plane and come see you. Just go to CatholicAnswerSpeakers.com to get all the information you need to make your event the talk of the town. That's CatholicAnswerSpeakers.com. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, my friends. Summer is here. That means summer reading. I have great news. Catholic Answers is having its first ever summer book sale in the online shop at Catholic.com. For a limited time, you can get dozens of great books offered at $10, $5, even as low as $1 a copy. Now is the time to load up on solid Catholic books for yourself, your friends, and your family. Save 50% or more on books by Jimmy Akin, Tim Staples, Rod Bennett, Gary Machuda, and a whole host of great authors. And my personal favorite, all the books in our Catholic Answers Classic series are marked down as well. Log on now and all this month to the store at shop.catholic.com and take advantage of our first ever summer sale. Log on today at shop.catholic.com.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
EWTN, communicating the faith.
I feel that God has been really doing a work in me in the last 5-10 years. I'm a convert to Catholicism, and I started to just really feel a passion to know more about the Catholic faith, and I started listening to Catholic radio all day. I'm not doing great things, but I'm doing small things with great love.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic. Call now with your question. 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, joined in studio by just one of the greatest apologists, speakers, writers you will ever meet, Carlo Broussard. And over sitting next to Carlo now is my best friend, Erica Olson. My best friend in the whole world.
How dare he? I thought I was your best friend.
Well, I thought that Carlo's introduction, I was like, he's about to say my name, but you didn't. And then I got a little sad, but that was good. That made up for it.
Yeah, it's weird when 54-year-old men talk about their best friend. I think that's usually third graders that do that.
Do you have a best friend?
You are my, it's you, Erica Olson.
Oh, you only say that because you want to go on all the cruises.
Why would you say that? That I'm being manipulative? That I would try to manipulate you to let me on the cruise?
Never.
Is Carlo going on the next cruise?
That's absurd. He is.
So I am. See,
he doesn't have
friend.
To say you're
I'm a good
he
friend.
Have to
He's
say
my
nicely.
Best friend, too.
Everybody's your best friend when it's time to decide who's going on the cruise.
Yeah.
So my best friend, Erica Olson, you're also the super extraordinaire events coordinator here, and we have a giant event coming up.
Yes.
It has been selling like hotcakes.
It is.
And we're coming up to an important date about it. So we're talking about the Faith and Science conference, one of the finest Faith and Science things you'll ever go to, maybe the best you'll ever go to.
Conference you'll ever go to, also.
It's going
to
be at the It's going to be at the Hyatt Regency over here in La Jolla. It's going to be in the beautiful end of September San Diego weather, which is probably the best weather in the world anywhere at any time of the year.
It really is.
And then
it's summer all day. It's summer all year long here, but that particular time, all the tourists have gone away. So
don't say that. Now you're hurting all of our
listeners'
feelings.
Well, no, I'm saying you're
Arizona.
I'm welcoming you all to come, and it'll be less
it's
crowded.
Nice when you leave.
For everyone who comes to our conference.
Okay, so but next week, I think Tuesday
Monday.
Is. Monday is the last day.
Monday is the last day. That you will have early bird pricing.
Okay.
So Tuesday.
Yeah.
And I can't tell you exactly what time Tuesday.
12:01 a.m.
Yeah, I will be changing the prices. So I will be getting up at midnight to change the prices. So
CatholicAnswersConference.com is where you
go. She might press the snooze, guys, so you might get a few extra minutes.
CatholicAnswersConference.com. Erica, you're not off the hook here, Broussard. I want to ask you about what you're talking about at the conference. But one more thing, though, because I heard today, seriously, someone, I think it might have been Chris Check told me this, could have been John Sorensen. There's only a few rooms left.
There's only a handful of room left. We are at 80% of our room block. That's huge. So everyone who's bought a ticket has also gotten a room reservation.
Yeah.
So if you are planning to come from out of town, you really don't want to delay in getting your tickets and your room reservation in, because our room block is going to sell out, and it's going to sell out fast. So more so than getting the early bird pricing, you really want to get that hotel reservation taken care of also.
And there will be local people who will come as well who won't need the hotel room. But if only 20% of the rooms are left, I thought we should tell people that. Carlo,
yeah, definitely.
You had an article recently that kind of wet the whistle of people.
Yeah, it went live on the Catholic Answers Magazine online, I think on Tuesday. Basically, responding to an objection. So once we review the philosophical worldview of scientism, like says science is the only source of objective truth, right?
Yes.
And you show the incoherence, the logical incoherence of that position, the question is, well, why do so many people embrace it? And one of the reasons why is because of they're hypnotized by the success of science. There are some philosophers and atheistic scientists who will make the argument that because science is so successful, right, there can't be anything else beyond what science can detect. In reality, it's got to be all there is, right? I mean, just look how successful science is and its technological power and predictive power, you know, technological application. So in the article, I offer ways to respond to that objection, and that's just a little wetting the whistle of a part of my talk at the conference of why science cannot eliminate God.
And where can you get the article?
At Catholic.com, and you just kind of scroll down to a few days ago on Tuesday at Catholic Answers Magazine online, in short, camo.
And if people want to get conference tickets, Carlo, let's see if you know, what's the website?
Erica, my lifeline. Yes, CatholicAnswersConference.com.
My very best friend, Erica Olson, thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks, BFF.
Yeah.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and you have the nicest hair in the studio today out of all of us.
Thank you. Yeah. I tried today. I knew I was coming on, so I brushed it especially for you guys.
Thanks, Erica, for finally brushing that mane on top of your head. CatholicAnswersConference.com, early bird pricing is over as of midnight Monday. So go ahead and get your tickets now. It is really going to be a lot of fun.
It is. Thank you.
That's it. That's all I got. Out of here, Olson.
I'll see you again some other time.
Our topic this hour with Carlo is basically comes down to, who is Jesus? Is he the Emmanuel, or is he just a mere prophet? Emmanuel means
God with us.
God with us.
Yeah.
Let's go to our Let's go to an anonymous caller in Nebraska listening on the Catholic Answers app. Anonymous, you are on with Carlo Broussard.
Hi, I've been reading your guys' Catholic Answers 20 questions.
Okay.
This one's 20 Answers God by Trent Horn. Good. And about Jesus. So, this is God. I believe that. I'm a Catholic. I'm just confused, I guess.
Okay.
Is it says that he still learns some parts of human life through experience. Now, God knows everything because he's omnipotent
and omniscient.
So. Right. Right, he's all those things, but was he blocked? Like, he didn't know all God's revelation? Did the human body not be able to hold that?
All right, this is a great question, Anonymous. I think I understand what you're getting at here. And so the key, Anonymous, to not fully understanding, but beginning to make comprehensible this, what we call in theology, the hypostatic union, right? And that is to say that the second person of the Blessed Trinity, the Son of God, has, and that is Jesus, right? He has two natures. He has a divine nature, and he has a human nature. So think of it as two sources of operation that this one person, the operator, can pull from, right? And so because he is fully God, he has the divine nature in totality, equal to the Father, he, the operator, the second person of the Blessed Trinity, the subject of action, can do everything that goes with being God. So he's omniscient, he's omnipotent. That omniscient means all-knowing for our listeners. Omnipotent means all-powerful, right? But because he also assumed to himself a human nature, he can do everything that goes with being human. So because he assumed himself to a human nature, he has a human intellect, he has a human will. And also, he can experience, via his human nature, all of the limitations that go with having a human nature. So this is why, Anonymous, that Jesus, the second person of the Blessed Trinity, we can ascribe to Jesus an increase in, or a growth in knowledge and wisdom and grace because of his human nature. It is because of his human nature that we can ascribe to Jesus, the person, the second person of the Blessed Trinity, experiencing the human condition of death and suffering. And he can experience human emotions such as anger and joy and all of the things that go with being human. So the key lies in the mystery of the union of these two natures, the divine nature and the human nature, joined in the one divine person, the second person of the Blessed Trinity. So that's sort of the key to explaining how Jesus, although he is God, by virtue of his divine nature that he has with the Father, he can also experience human limitations, such as limitation in knowledge, such as limitation in space and limitations of matter, etc. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. So that would be why the devil was able to tempt Jesus, even though it was unsuccessful, because he was still a human.
Right. Well, there is a distinction. There is a nuance to be made with regard to the temptations that Christ went through and underwent, as opposed to us. When we are tempted by the devil, Anonymous, because of our fallen human nature, That temptation, we're often tempted not only externally, but from within. We call it concupiscence, right? We have this inclination, or we're drawn to evil, we're drawn to sin by virtue of our fallen human nature. With regard to Christ, being that his human nature was perfected by virtue of the union that it had with the divine nature in the second person of the Blessed Trinity, the temptation that Christ experienced was entirely external. So there was nothing going on internally within him that was he was somehow attracted to the evil or drawn to the evil. In no way was he tempted like that. It was entirely external. But think about this, Anonymous. Because the temptation that Satan proposed to Jesus was entirely external and nothing going on internally, the temptation of Satan to Christ was everything Satan had. Satan had to throw everything at Jesus that he had in his bag, because there's no internal inclination to the sin that Satan can sort of work with, right?
Yeah.
That wasn't present in Jesus' human nature. So the temptation being entirely external, Satan had to give it all at Jesus. And Jesus still exercised his human will to say no to the temptations of Christ. Thank you, Zai. The temptations of Satan. Sorry.
Scared me for a second.
I'm everything. Does that help, Anonymous?
I think Anonymous has
he's dropped.
Okay. It wasn't me. Don't look at me. 888-318-7884 is the number. Carlo Broussard is our guest. Jesus, is he the Emmanuel or a mere prophet? We go now to Bob in Springfield, Massachusetts, listening to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. Bob, we might not have a time for a full answer before the break, but your question for Carlo, please.
Yes, I appreciate your show, and I listen to it now and then. And, you know, it's with charity that I say that, you know, what Carlos just said about his opinion on that, I would not accept that, or I would with charity, I disagree, that Christ, I think, is a unique person that was prophesied in the Old Testament, and that he himself said that he's not equal to God. He doesn't know when he's going to come back, and God is greater than him. Those are his words in the scripture. Okay. Paul said that he is the Son of God. Jesus was made lower than the angels, and he didn't consider himself equal to God. Even though he was the fullness of God, even though he was the Word sent from God, and even though he created everything, because he was the Word, but even at the end, when he conquers death, he even says that he's going to, or in Corinthians, they say he's going to lay down the baton that was handed to him, that made him the fullness of God, and he's going to give it back to the Father, Jehovah, and he's going to be worshipped all in all. So there's many different points where he doesn't consider himself equal to God, and he doesn't have the knowledge of when he's coming back.
Okay.
And it kind of honors, the Father's honored to give him that glory. He wants the Son to have the glory, but the glory is there for a time, and the fullness is there, but he was never equal to God, but even though he had the fullness there.
Okay, Bob, thank you for that. I believe that is the Jehovah's Witness perspective, and Carlo will give the Catholic response, but he's going to have to do that after the break, because we have to go to these messages at the bottom of the hour. So hang on, Bob. Don't go anywhere. We're happy to have your call, and we will address it right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Are faith and science compatible? Join us this September 27th to the 30th as we tackle the topic at Catholic Answers' 5th National Apologetics Conference. We've got an all-star lineup of speakers guaranteed to jumpstart your faith, including our very special keynote speaker, Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today to register. That's CatholicAnswersConference.com.
If only evangelization was easy. But the truth of the matter is that most of the time, it's not. Talking about the Catholic faith is enough of a challenge even before dealing with the roadblocks that keep people from listening with an open mind. Apologist Carlo Broussard recognized that as he wrote Prepare the Way, a guide to step-by-step strategies that readers can use to break down those barriers, barriers to the very existence of God and religious truth, barriers to basic Christian beliefs, and barriers to the distinctive teachings and claims of the Catholic Church. Don't let obstacles get in your way. Learn how to overcome them. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know that Catholic Answers Live is on TV? What began as a monthly series on EWTN in April of 2017 is now going to be coming to you on a weekly basis. You can catch Catholic Answers Live TV Saturdays at 5 p.m. Eastern Time on EWTN, with an encore at 2:30 a.m. on Sundays. We'll also be available soon on Apple TV, Roku, and the Augustine Institute's multimedia platform, Form. Make a point of making Catholic Answers Live TV part of your weekly viewing, and we'll see you on the airwaves. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and Cy short for Cyril. So I just wanted to say thanks to everybody who wished me a happy feast day today. I think I got more such wishes today than I ever have before in my life. Thanks, Mary, on Facebook for your good wishes, and everybody else on Facebook or wherever else. You know that there's three major saints named Cyril. Cyril from Cyril and Methodius, Cyril of Jerusalem, Cyril of Alexandria. So I get three.
Amen.
Big
three name days throughout the year, right?
That's right. How many St. Carlos are there?
Actually.
Oh, this is interesting.
From what I understand, Carlo is the derivative or akin to Carol. So
come on.
I can claim Pope St. John Paul II.
I knew that's where you were going.
Feast day.
Yeah. When is his feast day? Do you remember?
Don't ask, man. Okay. I'm horrible at the saints and the calendar. Unfortunately, I admit, I know.
Well, how are you at apologetics?
I don't know. I guess we need to find out.
All right, let's go. Let's do some of it. We'll find out. Bob from Springfield, Massachusetts, very generous in his manner of speaking to us, and we appreciate that. Bob. And looking for the Catholic perspective on why we insist that Jesus is God.
Is equal to the Father.
Right.
Yeah. So Bob was sharing with us that his position is that he doesn't think Jesus is equal to the Father. So here's what I would say, Bob, is we have to recognize that in Scripture, in Jesus' ministry, there are some things that he says, as you've indicated, that would seem to indicate he's not equal to the Father, such as Mark 13:32, with him saying the Son does not know the day or the hour, or other times when the Scripture speaks of Jesus growing in wisdom and growing in knowledge, right? But there are also other cases where Jesus, in what I'm going to present here, Bob, clearly suggests or clearly reveals that he does understand himself to be equal to the Father. And in the Christian tradition of understanding Jesus to have these two natures, we're able to account for all of these statements. So, for example, in Mark chapter 2, verse 5, Bob, Jesus claims to forgive the sins of the paralytic there in Mark 2. And notice he doesn't call upon the name of God. He doesn't call upon the power of God. He claims to forgive the man's sins by his own authority. And if you notice, Bob, that actually merits the charge of blasphemy in the minds of those present, which Jesus reads. Yet another power that only God can perform by his own authority. So Jesus reads their minds in the charge of blasphemy, and rather than correcting their blasphemous thoughts, Jesus actually affirms what they're thinking, because they thought to themselves, who can forgive sins but God alone? And Jesus affirms those thoughts by performing the miracle to raise the paralytic, to heal the paralytic, and which the miracle vindicates his claim to have the power by his own authority to forgive sins. In Matthew 11, Bob, 10 through verses 2 through 10, we read about how Jesus identifies John the Baptist as the messenger prophesied about in Malachi chapter 3 and Isaiah chapter 40. Now, that messenger in Malachi 3 and Isaiah 40 was a messenger to prepare a way for Yahweh, for Almighty God. And Jesus says John is that messenger, and John is preparing a way for him, Jesus. And so what does that make Jesus? That makes Jesus equal to Yahweh. So Jesus understands himself to be equal to Almighty God. We can look at John's gospel. In John chapter 10, verses 30 through 33, we read the narrative of how the Jews sought to stone Jesus. And the Jews, John records, the Jews saying, "We don't stone you for a work that you've done on the Sabbath. We stone you because you, a man, have made yourself equal to God." And the reason why they thought that, Bob, was because Jesus called God the Father in such a way that it merited this charge of blasphemy. And that's why they were seeking to kill him. And Jesus does not correct their line of thought. And then finally, we look in the writings of the early Christians. In Colossians 2:9, for example, Paul says that the fullness of the deity dwells bodily in Jesus Christ. If Jesus has the fullness of the divine nature, Bob, well then, he is equal to the Father by virtue of possessing that divine nature. So that would be the positive evidence that I would put forward initially to see that Jesus indeed does understand himself to be equal to the Father. And then, of course, we would have to address those other passages that you brought up. But let's see what you think of that, Bob.
Bob?
Okay, thank you. Yes, thank you. And so I hear what you're saying, but I still have to go back to that Jesus is a unique person. The Christ that was prophesied was a very unique person, and that he is the mediator between man and God.
Mm-hmm.
So even there, by him being a mediator, he's pointing, he's going to bring us to the Heavenly Father. So in that case, I would say, well, he's even saying that he's a mediator. And I know the fullness that you're talking of, the fullness of, that was given to him. Jesus doesn't do his own will. The Jesus of Mary, the one that walked the earth, he doesn't do his own will. Everything he does because the Father told him to do it, or okay, because he heard it. Even his resurrection was given to him. So you're right in saying that he is God in the fullness. But when you go to Corinthians and he says, when everything is done, all this stuff that was given to him, he's going to lift that back at the feet of Jehovah, and he's going to be worshipped all in all. He is the right hand of the Father. He is the Word made flesh.
Okay. All right. Now, Bob, I think there's a way in the Christian tradition to explain and provide a rationale behind what you're saying, while at the same time acknowledging that he is equal to the Father. And that is by virtue of the human nature that the second person of the Blessed Trinity possesses, allows him to be the mediator between man and God. As St. Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, there is one mediator between God and man, the man, Jesus Christ. Now, just because Paul affirms that Jesus, the Word, is man, it doesn't follow from that he's not God, precisely because they're not mutually exclusive given the conceptual framework of the Christian tradition, that the second person of the Blessed Trinity, Jesus, can be both God, Jesus can be both God by virtue of his divine nature, and man by virtue of the human nature that he has, which allows him to be the mediator between God and man. And, you know, Bob, you're talking about Jesus doing the will of the Father. Jesus often talks about doing the will of his Father. But we have to keep in mind, Bob, that given this conceptual framework of him having two natures, he can use, it is correct for him to ascribe to himself that he does the will of the Father via his human will. His human will is subject to the divine will. So when Jesus speaks of doing the will of the Father, as Christians in traditional Christianity, we say, amen, because we have a rationale for explaining that, namely his human will, which comes from his human nature, but that in no way excludes him also possessing the divine will by virtue of him having the divine nature in union with the Father.
Bob, we'll have to leave it there. We have other calls to get to. I hope that that was helpful. I'm very grateful for your call. Thank you. 888-31-TRUTH is our number. Our question for today, Jesus, is he Emmanuel or mere prophet? Is he God or is he merely a man? We go now to Tara in Kansas City, listening to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. Tara, your question for Carla Broussard.
Hi, yeah, thank you. So my question boils down to the bloodline of Jesus.
Okay.
I've been taught that it goes through, you know, the house of David, and you can follow his bloodline through the Bible. However, I know that Joseph is the one that descended from the house of David, which would suggest if Jesus was as well, that Joseph was his actual father. So I was wondering how we could explain that.
Right. Well, Jesus would not be of the bloodline of Joseph, although he does stand in lineage, sitting on the throne of the house of David, to be in that lineage as the Davidic king by virtue of his legal adoption of Jesus being legally adopted by Joseph. So although he's not the blood son of Joseph, he is the legal son of Joseph. And by virtue of that legal adoption, he would stand in that lineage to inherit the throne of David. So just because he's not of the bloodline of Joseph, it doesn't follow from that that he wouldn't be in that lineage to inherit the throne.
I got you. That makes perfect sense. I really appreciate it.
All righty.
Thank you very much for that call. We got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Jesus, Emmanuel, or Mere Prophet with Carla Broussard right after this.
Your questions, Catholic Answers, live.
Catholic Answers is doing it again. We're holding our fifth annual Apologetics Conference this September in beautiful San Diego, California, and we'd like to see you there.
We've had a wonderful time going home all enthused.
Every time we come here, it's just an incredible experience.
Normally, you'd have to root through a dozen different books to get half the stuff I've learned here.
These guys are so amazing. I always get so much, learn so much. I've already signed up for next year.
Join us this September 27th to the 30th for a lively and inspiring conference with an all-star lineup of speakers guaranteed to jumpstart your faith. All of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and special keynote speaker, Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke.
I enjoy the atmosphere and the friendliness of the people. I'm having a great time.
I love it. I love it. I'm so glad I came here.
I've just learned so much. You know, I've been a Catholic all my life. It's just been so wonderful.
I love it. I want to come back every year.
Catherine Zeltner.
There are so many misconceptions when it comes to abortion and assisted suicide. It's really confusing, and I think for a lot of people, they don't know how to talk about these things. EWTN Pro-Life Weekly, we help to change that. We help to really untangle these web of lies. Listeners can expect to become informed and then grow more confident so that they can then discuss and dialogue these issues, and together we can really impact culture in that way.
EWTN Pro-Life Weekly, Sunday morning at 10 a.m. on EWTN Radio.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. So happy to have you with us. Next hour, philosopher John Cutteback will be here, and we're going to talk about living a truly human life. You might have noticed that the modern world makes it hard to live a truly and fully human life, but there is somebody that we're even talking about this hour who promised the fullness of life. So We might have some answers for that. 888-31-TRUTH is our number. This hour, we're talking with Carlo Broussard, the author of Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel and the Church, about the identity of Jesus. I got to ask you about something, though. You're going to Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Yes.
Yeah. How are you getting there? Driving?
I'm flying.
Bus, flying. Oh, flying.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yep. Just flying. Regular flight.
And when do you go to Tulsa, Oklahoma?
July 9th, 10th, and 11th. I'm going to Christ the King Catholic Church, and I'll be giving a three-night mission there for kind of like a dinner and lecture series that they have going on. There's
awesome.
Like a dinner at like 6 or 6:30, somewhere around there. They can just Google Christ the King Catholic Church, go to their website. In their events section, they have the brochure there that gives all the information.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's been a great joy working with the group that's been working with our seminar coordinator, Jen Phelps, here and getting us over there. They've been very excited for the event and getting ready for it. So it's been quite a joy. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, they've got Catholic radio all over Oklahoma. But there's not that many Catholics, percentage-wise, in Oklahoma. I learned this when I was at EWTN the last time.
That's
some wonderful people supporting.
Praise God that Catholic radio is there. You know, I'm sure it'll bear much fruit.
It's so cool when a parish does something like that, though. Dinner and then three nights of talks.
Yep, dinner and a talk. So that begs the question, well, what am I talking about? So I'm going to be talking about purgatory, salvation. I think it's salvation on the first night, purgatory on the second night, and then confession on the third night. So your basic Catholic Protestant conversation on how to talk about these issues related to the Bible, and then some catechesis as well, you know, the what and the why.
Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah. Don't forget to say thank you for dinner, Carlo.
Amen to that.
Represent us well there.
Right? I will.
We need you on your best behavior.
I'll eat extra for you. So.
Okay, all right. We're talking about the identity of Jesus. Is he Emmanuel or mere prophet? We go now to Alex in Texas, listening on 1430 AM. Alex, your question for Carlo Broussard.
Hello, Carlo Broussard. How are you today, sir?
I'm doing well, Alex. Thanks for calling us, brother.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me. I just heard you explain to Anonymous a little earlier that I do believe that Jesus is Emmanuel, that he is God with us.
Right.
And, you know, I heard you explain earlier about him having the two natures. And that does sound very good. I think that is... that is probably, in my mind, what I feel is the truth about him from what I can read. And so basically, when you mentioned earlier that he didn't have the fallen nature.
Right.
It kind of made me feel like it explained that he wasn't all human like I am.
Okay.
So I was wondering, could it be that he had the fallen nature, but just did not fall? Is that a good way to explain that?
Well, actually, the answer to that question would be no. It would not be a good way to explain it. Notice, Alex, that you're operating on the assumption that to be fully human is to have a fallen human nature, or to be fully human is to have the possibility to sin or the inclination to sin. But notice that that assumption is actually contrary to what traditional Christianity has thought about human nature. No, it's the opposite, actually, Alex. To be fully human is to be free from sin, right? I mean, this is why Jesus became man, in order to empower us to be fully human, promising us that destination where we receive our bodies back in that glorious resurrection, where in our full human nature we will be free from sin and human to the max, right?
Right.
We will be fully human. Sin actually weakens human nature. Sin is an imperfection, Alex, not a perfection. So perfect human nature is human nature free from sin. Perfect human nature is human nature free from even the inclination to sin. So that Jesus had a human nature that wasn't fallen, wasn't weakened, it doesn't follow that he was, less human than we are. Actually, it's the opposite. He was fully human. Now, this is not to say that if you're a sinner, you're somehow, less of a human being, right? Because you're either a human being or you're not. You either have a human nature or you're not. But given this conceptual framework of Aristotle and Aquinas of of the goodness of something being the fullness of what it is, right? You can have defective instances of something. You got a dog with three legs, that's still a dog, but it's a defective instance of a dog, right?
Yeah.
So too with human beings who are sinners. You and I, Si, we're sinners, brother. You more so than me. No, I'm just joking.
You're actually not. I'm convinced that that's probably true.
But We're defective instances of human nature, of what human nature is supposed to be. Human nature in its full is perfectly ordered to God, right? And free from sin.
Yeah.
So the fact that we do sin is a defect in us. That Christ didn't have the defect doesn't make him less human. It makes him all the more human. Does that make sense, Alex?
It makes sense. I like that. That does make sense. It kind of makes me wonder, though, because I, just for my own clarification, right? I am a sinner, obviously, but I'm still human.
Right.
And so maybe... And I understand that when he's come to give us life and more abundant life.
John 10:10, amen.
And so when I am with Jesus, then we will have that perfect human nature.
Amen, brother. And that's the beauty. We are in this state of journeying to perfection, and Christ comes to perfect our human nature, to free us from sin. In this life, he frees us from sin. If we fall into sin, he gives us the grace to be freed from sin and to journey to our ultimate perfection. But in the end, we will be completely perfected. I think St. Paul in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, if my memory serves me correct, says, you know, what God has begun in you, Christ will bring to completion. And so that's the beauty of the Christian message, that Christ comes to complete us, to perfect us, to really make us fully human, to be what God has ordained us to be.
Yes. So therefore, he was not of the fallen nature, and because of that, he was the perfect sacrifice for us.
Amen. And amen to that, Alex. And it's one important point here, Si, to note is that the lack of sin in Jesus, the lack of the inclination to sin, and even in Jesus, he lacked the ability to sin precisely because of that unique union that his human nature had to the divine person, the second person of the Blessed Trinity. Unlike Mary, who didn't have a fallen human nature, right?
Right.
She was free from sin, okay? She didn't have a fallen human nature, but she... Unlike Jesus, she's not united to the second person of the Blessed Trinity in the way that it is for Jesus, right? So Mary had the ability to sin, right? It's not like she was impeccable.
Yeah.
She had the ability, although she chose not to sin, given the church's teaching and divine revelation. But with Jesus, he didn't even have the ability to sin because of that unique relationship that his human nature had to his person, which is a divine person, the second person of the Blessed Trinity.
Alex, thanks so much. We're going to move because I got to try to get to as many people as I can before the hour ends, but we appreciate your call. Jesus, Emmanuel, or mere prophet is our question today. We go now to Grant in Houston, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. Grant, you are on with Carla Broussard.
Hello. My question regards the caller presenting a Jehovah's Witness perspective, and he's quoted a verse from Corinthians, I believe, and I didn't hear Carlo address it, and it stirred some confusion in me because I hadn't really heard that verse, even though I've read scripture and am Catholic. So I was wondering if Carlo could provide the Catholic perspective on Jesus laying a baton at the foot of Jehovah.
Yeah, actually, Grant, I'm going to be honest with you, brother.
I've never heard that.
The biblical citation is not registering right now. I haven't come across that passage. There may be something that speaks of something similar to that. I'm not sure. So I really can't comment on the passage because there was no citation given and nothing is popping in my mind right now on precisely what the previous caller was referring to.
In some cases, those are translation issues. And it's also the case that the Bible translation used by Jehovah's Witnesses is not a reliable translation of the Bible.
Correct. There are very many words added in there to change the theological meaning of it. But even this, even just the idea, Grant, you know, let's just think about the idea itself. If Jesus has been given things over to him from the Father in his earthly mission, and Jesus is going to take that which the Father has given to him in his earthly mission, present it back to him, laying it down at the Father's feet, that in no way serves as an obstacle to belief in Jesus' divinity, precisely because we believe that Jesus is fully man. So in utilizing his human will, he's operating with his human intellect and human will to take that which he has done with his human intellect and will in his earthly ministry and offer that to the divine will, his Father, the divine nature, right, in worship, and lay it down at his feet. So in no way does even the idea of Jesus laying things down at the feet of the Father contradict his divinity, precisely because he does these things via his human nature.
Sure, yeah, I think that's an excellent, well-rounded response, and I appreciate you indicating that the translation isn't necessarily reliable either, because I'm not familiar with Jehovah's Witnesses. And
it is one of the problems of dialogue with Jehovah's Witnesses sometimes, is you look in your Bible. As a matter of fact, when you speak to a Jehovah's Witness and they show you something in a Bible, it's best if you have a Bible there with you to look at the passage yourself if you have a good translation of the Bible. But it's among the many difficulties of that conversation. Thanks, Grant, for that call. I'm going to real quick go to Richard in San Antonio, listening on Guadalupe Radio. And Richard, if you could be very, very quick with your question, we'll try to get you an answer.
Yeah, thank you for taking my call. I had a question about, it deals with the nature of Jesus, because in Revelation, when they show the heavenly mass and they see the Son of Man is talking to John, but he shows on the altar that there's a lamb on the altar as if it was slain.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, how did that reconcile with the divine, the human, and what was John seeing at that moment?
Okay, right, Carlo?
Yeah, well, I think, Richard, the key here is that, John saw a lamb, that's what he describes, he saw a lamb as if it were slain, but in no way are we to conclude from that Jesus is literally a lamb. These are metaphors, right? These are images and metaphors that are being used to describe Jesus, whom in his human nature, right, offered himself up to the Father on the cross in sacrifice for the redemption of the world. That's why the incarnation is so important, precisely because via his human nature, mankind is redeemed.
Richard, you did a great job saying that question quickly. We appreciate it. Thanks to all of our callers today. Next hour, we're going to talk about living a truly human life. Carlo, again, the dates when you're going to be in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
July 9th, 10th, and 11th.
And the parish?
Christ the King Catholic Church.
All right, you can find him there. You can also find him at CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com or find his book, Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel, and the Church. Thank you, Carlo.
Thank you, brother.
We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
What are miracles, and why does God work them? How can I believe in miracles if I've never experienced one? Aren't miracles just something pre-scientific people made up to explain what they couldn't understand? 20 Answers Miracles unpacks the nature of miracles, their appearances in Scripture and history, how the Church evaluates them, and ways to answer doubters who say they're mere superstition. 20 Answers Miracles is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com today and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
Hey everyone, this is Carlo Broussard, and I'm here to tell you about something of eternal importance, the very existence of God. Today's atheists have a new tactic when it comes to talking about God's existence. We don't need God to explain the universe, they say. Science can take care of that. We also don't need him to be moral or happy. Some even say your arguments in favor of God don't even deserve a reply because they're not real explanations to begin with, like science is. Not only does God probably not exist, they argue, he doesn't even matter. In my brand new DVD, Why God Still Matters, I don't let our atheist friends off so easy. I take apart the premises of those who say God's irrelevant and teach you what you need to demonstrate why God is just as important, in fact, in today's world, more important than ever. Don't let atheists shut down the argument before it begins. Get your copy of Why God Still Matters by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Want to tell others about your Catholic faith, but don't know where to start? Afraid you're not smart enough, knowledgeable enough, outgoing enough? Don't worry, says Catholic Answers apologist Trent Horn. With a few simple tips and a little practice, anyone can be an effective apostle and evangelist. In his new DVD, The Three Secrets to Sharing the Faith, Horn draws on years of experience to identify for you the most important steps to initiating such discussions and making them fruitful. Produced in a new and engaging documentary format, The Three Secrets to Sharing the Faith will give you hard facts, demonstrations, and real-life encounters to help you become a more fluent champion of God's church and his truth. You don't need to be tongue-tied anymore. Order your copy of The Three Secrets to Sharing the Faith today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hello, my friends. This is Catholic Answers President Christopher Check, and I'm here to tell you about a unique resource just out from Catholic Answers Press. One of the ways Jesus answered his critics was to use their own words against them, showing how even the enemies of the faith admitted crucial facts that undermined their own positions. And it's been that way through the ages. It's proved impossible for those out to destroy the faith to mount their attacks without tripping themselves up and inadvertently testifying to the truth of what they're trying to destroy. In his new book, Hostile Witnesses, How the Historic Enemies of the Church Prove Christianity, renowned author Gary Machuda looks at dozens of Christianity's most notorious foes from biblical times to the present day and draws from their antagonistic words and deeds surprising testimony to gospel truths. Rich in research and written with clarity and force, Hostile Witnesses is a unique contribution to Catholic apologetics and one that speaks with special urgency to a modern world in which the faith is under attack like never before. If you love apologetics, you need to order your copy of Hostile Witnesses today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for this book at a Catholic bookstore in your area.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to our second great big giant Wednesday hour here on Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. And this hour, we discuss living a truly human life. Is it, maybe it's possible, have you considered this possibility anyways, that the modern world, for all its many accomplishments, is making it actually harder for people to live truly human lives? What if modern people have kind of forgotten basic truths about humanity, and we live lives of frustration as a result of having forgotten those things? Can we learn how to live lives that are truly human? Would we choose it if we could? What would such lives look like anyways? Living truly human lives is our topic today. Your questions are welcome at 888-318-7884. Our guest this hour is Christendom College philosophy professor John A. Cutaback. Dr. Cutaback is a graduate of Christendom College and the Catholic University of America, where he earned his PhD. He's the author of True Friendship, Where Virtue Becomes Happiness, from Epic Publishing, and he is the founder and curator of Bacon from Acorns. That's a website, baconfromacorns.com, which aims through philosophy to help people live more human, happier lives. Dr. John Cutaback, thanks for being with us.
It's great to be with you, Si. Thank you.
So you start out at Christendom College and then you end up there. So it must be quite an extraordinary place, Christendom College.
To be frank, yeah, it is. I fell in love with philosophy here, and I've count myself very blessed to have the opportunity to help other people fall in love with it too.
You know, you're teaching people to live the good life there, I think. I think that's what, and I remember when I was a kid, if you said living the good life, it would have meant, and maybe it still does mean this in popular culture, it meant like living like Robin Leach, lifestyles of the rich and famous kind of life. And then I went to college and they said, oh, that's not what philosophers mean by the good life. Is there something to that? Is the good life other than what is lived by the rich and famous? And is there ancient wisdom that can help us find that good life?
Well, that's certainly the question. I love it. You know, I've always enjoyed and been fascinated by the fact that these ancient thinkers raised these issues in very, very powerful ways. For instance, Socrates would go around Athens and he would say things, this is paraphrasing, but this fundamentally is what he did. He'd say, I know people who are good carpenters. I know people who are good soldiers. I know people who are good politicians. But I know very few people who are good men. People know how to do all kinds of things, and they spend a lot of time studying how to do this and how to do that, but very few study and really consider this most fundamental of all questions: how do you be a good man? So this really was what Socrates was all about. His great student Plato's great student Aristotle. My view is, and actually there's church fathers who held this too, it was just a very special grace and gift given to humanity that in a special way these three men had the insights that they did, captured them the way they did, and are able to help guide us to ask these very basic questions in such a way as to come to some really key answers.
Why is it then I get the impression, and please correct me, you're the professor of philosophy, but I get the impression that if you ask one of these ancient philosophers, how do I attain the fullness of life or how do I live a good life, they would have useful answers for you in a way that a modern philosopher would not. What happened? Or am I wrong about that?
Well, I mean, by and large, so always have to be careful in painting with broad strokes. But by and large, I think you're absolutely right. And frankly, as I say to my students, you know, have a seat and let's take a couple of years to try to figure out what's happened. I mean, that right there is in many ways the story of humanity for a couple of millennia. And there certainly is no simple answer there. Many contemporary thinkers hold a kind of myth of progress, as though you can always count on the fact that humanity is going to come to deeper and deeper insights, and basically we're going to be getting better and better. I just don't think that's the truth. The fact is, the freedom is always there, and how we're doing as individuals, particularly how we're doing as a culture, because we are very much social animals, is up in the air and is to be determined by how we act. So really, great question. What went wrong? We could keep it simple. I mean, sin went wrong in various specific ways. But the great thing is the wisdom is always there. There's always been a tradition that's carried it on. From those ancients and Christians picked it up. And of course, Christianity provides a deeper wisdom and it fulfills those things. So it's easy to be distracted by the fact that now most philosophers out there give bad answers to the fundamental questions, or they don't even ask the right questions. That's deeply discouraging, and it has profound effects on us and the world around us.
But what about if I come at it from another direction? There's probably a large part of the Christian world who will say the introduction of philosophy, these ancient Greek philosophers into Christianity, this is what polluted Christianity. We need to get back to some kind of pure gospel. How do we address that?
Yeah, that is an extremely important question. And here I go to, I'll kind of say my great mentor and teacher, St. Thomas Aquinas. I say I have teachers that are alive in this world, and I have teachers that are not alive in this world. So when I refer to St. Thomas Aquinas, he points out that there's a light of reason and there's a light of faith. They are both lights. They never contradict one another, but by God's loving and generous plan, both have their role. And for the light of faith to work as it should, the light of reason needs to be functioning well. The Catholic Church has certainly always held this and has always been a great proponent of the natural sciences, in a particular way, the queen of the natural sciences, philosophy, because it provides the fundamental insights. There is already the fundamental wisdom there that provides the context and foundation for understanding divine revelation. So good philosophy is handmaiden. It goes hand in hand with good theology, with the faith.
Do you feel as a teacher of philosophy that if you get people asking questions and looking to the ancients for the answers they had, that is a kind of pre-evangelization maybe, or a preparation for them to come fully to the gospel of Jesus Christ?
I absolutely do. And interestingly, I mean, the gift of the light of natural reason is always an enduring and powerful gift for those who have the faith and for those who don't have the faith. I spend most of my time teaching people who have the faith, and it's always interesting to me how it stretches them, how it puts their faith into a new light. It really does empower them, enable them to look again, see again in many ways, maybe kind of for a first time, to realize how Christianity itself has the answers to these questions which the great ancient philosophers help us formulate. On the other hand, quickly, there's also the fact that philosophy has a great power to reach people who don't have the faith. This is one of the things I love about philosophy. It's key for those who have the faith. It never loses its importance for those who have the faith, but it always has a unique role, particularly in the world in which we live, where there is so little faith. I'm not saying we don't preach Jesus Christ. I'm a Catholic. I am all deeply convinced that the way to reach people is fundamentally to preach Jesus Christ. At the same time, we have to be wise as serpents. We have to understand what to say in what context, and sometimes to be able to advert to philosophy, to use a certain wisdom that does not appeal to the faith, can often be a very powerful way of evangelizing.
888-318-7884 is our number. You're listening to Catholic Answers Live, and our guest is philosopher John Cuddeback. We're asking the most basic question: how do you live a truly human life? And it's a particularly pressing question, I would suggest to you, and I will continue to ask Dr. Cuddeback his view, as modernity becomes more and more frustrating to people. The modern life provides more and more things, and it also provides a higher and higher level of frustration in the world. One that I would suggest, I don't know how you feel about this, Dr. Cuddeback, now often has us at one each other's throats, because we as much as we are these liberated modern selves, life is somehow lacking something for us.
Yeah, I think that's well said. And here I'm going to take us back to Socrates for a moment. And in a little book of his, I highly recommend. It's accessible, and at the same time absolutely profound. It's called The Apology, or sometimes just translated as The Defense of Socrates. It's the account of the speech he gave when he was on trial. But one of the things that he says that he would do is he would challenge people. And he would say, are you living? I love this line. Are you living as though the most important things are most important? Or are you living as though less important things have more importance than they do? And he literally goes on to say, are you living as though what's most important is the truth and the goods of your soul and your character? Or are you being distracted by wealth and power and honors? Some things never change. I mean, the fundamental dichotomy was right there, and he saw it. What is a truly human life? Our culture is living as though things that are not most human are most important. And Socrates called it in ancient Athens. He can call it for us today also.
888-318-7884 is the number. I mentioned your website, Bacon from Acorns. We'll talk about that a little bit on the other side, because it strikes me as a very practical undertaking, writing and speaking in ways that help people identify the truth about life so that they can live that truth and experience the fullness of their own lives. A pretty good project you got going on over there. We'll talk about that when we come back. And your questions for Dr. Cutaback are welcome. 888-318-7884. Truly human life is our topic this hour. 888-318-7884. Right back with that after this on Catholic Answers Live.
We're glad you're with us. Stick around for more Catholic Answers Live.
Summer is upon us, and though the temperatures are going up, the prices are coming down during Catholic Answers' first ever summer book sale in the online shop at Catholic.com. For a limited time, dozens of great books are available for $10, $5, even as low as $1 a copy. This is the time to load up on solid Catholic books for you, your friends, and your family. The spectacular online event offers savings of 50% and more on books by Jimmy Akin, Tim Staples, Rod Bennett, Gary Machuda, and a whole host of esteemed authors, evangelists, and apologists. We've even got all of the books in our Catholic Answers Classics series marked down. Log on now to shop.catholic.com and take advantage of what will be one of the most exciting sales of the summer. You know it's all good stuff because it's from the people you know and trust at Catholic Answers. Log on to shop.catholic.com and start saving today.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and I'm really excited to tell you about a special limited time offer we've got right now on subscriptions of our award-winning Catholic Answers magazine. Sign up today during our annual subscription drive, and not only can you save big bucks off the normal price, we'll give you a digital subscription of the magazine for free. Subscribe today by calling 818-487-2011 or by logging online to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com. Sign up for a one-year subscription, and we'll give you $10 off the normal price. But better yet, become a two-year subscriber, and we'll up the ante by dropping the price by $20. That's a savings of $10 to $20 plus a free digital subscription when you sign up for Catholic Answers Magazine. Act now, because this is our best offer of the year, and it's only available for a limited time. Subscribe to Catholic Answers Magazine before our annual subscription drive ends. Phone 818-487-2011 or go to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
As a human being, I have to admit that the question how to live a truly human life strikes me as an important one, but also one that I have spent most of my life probably avoiding. And if you're at all like me, we'll take a moment here and we'll consider what makes a truly human life. And we are a Catholic radio show, so of course we consider the place of Christ in that. Dr. John Cutaback is our guest this hour. He is professor of philosophy at Christendom College. We have all these graduates in here that work for us from Thomas Aquinas College. I don't know, we got like a pipeline coming down, and they all tell me that Christendom is almost as good as Thomas Aquinas College. I don't know if that is a fair thing to say or...
Well, they're almost right.
I'm so glad to hear you had a comeback for them. I never know what to say to them. Okay, so ancient wisdom can help us to live truly human lives. Let's say that I have been listening and I'm convinced of that. Give me some ancient wisdom.
Well, okay. Here's one shot of it that, to me, is at the center, and as I like to say to my students, fasten your seatbelt because it's powerful. And even if we've heard words like this before, we can never hear them too much, and we need to try to look again and see the wisdom that is therein. Aristotle, when he asks what human happiness is, he explains, happiness is not the reward that you get for having been virtuous. To be virtuous is to be happy. To live virtuously is happiness in action.
All right, I'm gonna pose a immediate problem comes to mind, that virtuous people so often end up just suffering for virtue. I mean, virtue would seem to be almost to require suffering.
Yep, and that's where, well asked. That's where part of the wisdom is to see that suffering and happiness are not incompatible. That we have to suffer, that we do suffer, experience shows, is often very much a part of the lives of those who are most happy.
So that would suggest to me that when Jesus says to us the words that we really don't like to hear, take up your cross each day and follow me, he's actually giving us a formula for our happiness?
He is. He absolutely is. Now here, I am going to come back and qualify it by saying this. Ultimately, and honestly, you could do this from the viewpoint of natural, and in general, when we're taking the viewpoint of natural reason, and I'm going to insist that it fits perfectly with our faith, even if I'm not necessarily, enunciating the faith. So you can say this either from the viewpoint of natural reason itself, or you can go to the faith. But from either one, we can see suffering is necessary because it is a part of how we grow in virtue. It's the virtue that constitutes our happiness. Our Lord is not going to say that suffering is happiness. Aristotle's certainly not going to say that suffering is happiness.
I see.
But is suffering absolutely incompatible with happiness? No. And might it be a key part of how we develop our character and become ourselves? Yes. And this is where I love how Aristotle points out that we should grow in wisdom. Not everyone who grows in age does grow in wisdom. There are people that are old in years, he says, but still young in character. But as we grow, we really should be able to see, particularly if we're striving to live well, we should be able to see in our own lives and those around us how suffering has become integrated into a lovely life. Think of marriage. Think of how in a good marriage you suffer together, but then that is actually part of what has made you stand in the relationship that you do. That right there, I think, is a great natural analogy of what our Lord is saying to us. He's in a sense looking us in the eyes the way spouses can and say, we can do this together. This is going to be difficult, but we are going to work this through. And in the very suffering, we are becoming more ourselves. Happiness doesn't equal suffering, but suffering in a kind of mysterious way, granted, mysterious way, is a part of our growing in character and our coming to happiness.
All right, you said something there a couple times that I think is going to be baffling to many of our listeners. And I'll admit to my being baffled by it myself at times, but you said becoming ourselves. I think a couple times you said that. It's part of the process of becoming ourselves. Yeah. I am myself. What could that possibly mean, becoming ourselves?
Right, okay. Good, thanks. You are and you aren't. I think that's the thing we need to see. Sure, I'm John Cutterback, but in very important ways, I am not yet the man I can and should be. So we're going to just focus on this for a moment. This is where St. Thomas has a great line, ubi amor, ibi oculus. Where there's love, you can see. It's a great principle in relationships. It's the person who really loves you who really understands you, mm-hmm. who can really see you. So picture this. I'll give the example of a parent and a child. Same thing, we could do it between spouses, but how about between a parent and a child? The parent is often able to see what that child can be. And seeing what the child can be, it is having an insight really into, I say, who the person is, in the sense of who the person is called to be. This is part of the beautiful notion that naturally is expressed by Aristotle's notion of nature. A nature is on its way someplace, and nature has not become itself until it has fulfilled the potentialities that have been written into it. And so this goes for all human beings. We all have the potential to be something great, just as human, and then amazingly, each in our own personal, particular way. And so I can say about you, Cy, if I knew you better,
yeah,
I'd be able, if I were a good friend of yours, I would have eyes to see and to help you see where you are falling short of being who you're supposed to be.
That is why I never call my friends back. You have nailed it right on the head. because I don't want to hear it. But I appreciate that you made that point. I didn't want to neglect to talk about bacon from acorns, and I'm not going to. But I do annoy people by monopolizing the conversation sometime, and we have many callers. How about we at least take a call before I go back
Great.
To asking you about bacon for acorns?
Great.
All right.
No problem.
We're talking about living truly human lives today. We're talking about using philosophy and the wisdom of the church to get there. 888-31-TRUTH is the number. Tom in Ohio, listening on 820 AM, is our first caller. Tom, your question for Dr. John Cutaback.
Oh, greetings. Can you all hear me?
We can. Thank you.
Hey, is Plotinus's writings on the soul, as he describes it, is that contrary to Catholic teaching?
That's a tough question. Plotinus is, for those who don't know, is called a Neoplatonic thinker. He came after the great trio of Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. He had a great influence, for instance, on St. Augustine, the great father of the church. I'm going to put it this way. That's a deeper issue. In short, I'm going to say Plotinus has some great insights. There's some things that he holds that are absolutely incompatible with Christianity. That doesn't mean he doesn't have some great insights. So, as with a number of other philosophers, you have to be careful with Plotinus. Some good things there, you got to be careful. In short, that's my answer.
Any one thing in particular that you can point to?
You know what the most important thing with Plotinus is that he holds that God created of necessity. And so he doesn't hold that creation came from a free act of love on the God's part. It was more of a necessary emanation from God. And so that is obviously contrary to a very fundamental aspect of Christianity. There are a couple other things that we could talk about. Plotinus doesn't have the rich Aristotelian Aristotle's understanding of the relationship of soul and body as being related to one another as form and matter, two principles of one substance. And so there's some things there when it comes down to some very important deeper points about understanding human nature. Plotinus is not going to be your best guide, but that doesn't mean that he doesn't have some incredible insights about the centrality of contemplation, about the importance of moral character, about the importance of turning from lower things to higher things, to try to tune in to the one from whom we have come, and only therein is happiness. Plotinus does see that.
Tom, you can probably hear the music. That means we got to take a quick break. Thank you so much for that question. If you'd like to speak with Dr. John Cutaback about living truly human lives, give us a call, 888-318-7884. We'll be right back with more of that right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
What difference does it make who or what you worship or what you believe? Sharing the faith used to make some people mad because it challenged their own strong beliefs. Today, it makes a lot of people yawn because they don't have strong beliefs about anything. Religious indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates modern culture. This is Matt Nelson, and in my new book, Just Whatever, I'll take down the building blocks of religious indifference one by one. We'll look at the different kinds of indifference you tend to encounter in your friends and family members to see where they come from and why they're seductive. What you believe matters. Find out why and what to do about it in my new book, Just Whatever. You can order your copy of Just Whatever by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
God helps those who help themselves. Preach the gospel always. When necessary, use words. We all hear sayings like these, and we assume they come from the Bible, the saints, or famous Christian writers. Nobody can seem to place their origin, but by sheer repetition, they've acquired a halo of truth. In my new book, What the Saints Never Said, I look at over 40 of these well-known sayings and track them back to their original sources. You'll be surprised at what I found. Some are close to what was really said. Many were misattributed or twisted beyond their original meaning, and more than a few of these sayings were simply made up. I hope by setting the record straight, I can make you aware of the theological errors that can lead us away from the faith and offer you authentic quotes from scripture, saints, and scholars that will draw you closer to our faith. Get your copy of What the Saints Never Said by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am just so pleased to have Dr. John Cuddeback here with us, talking about living truly human lives. Lots of wisdom among the ancients in that regard, and we do ourselves a great favor when we try to tap that. I did kind of mention your website, Bacon from Acorns, and people can find that at baconfromacorns.com. I hope you do. I now get a message from you on Wednesdays. And what is it you're trying to do there at Bacon from Acorns?
In a word, I'm trying to take what I love about philosophy in the classroom and bring it to a wider audience. I had the blessing and the opportunity to see year in and year out in the classroom how these fundamental principles, these fundamental insights of the ancients, change people's lives, perhaps most of all, by giving them the wherewithal to think clearly about how to live. And so I just, with that in mind, I started a website where I thought, this is what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna do something short once a week. I'll do my Wednesday quote. I'll take some great quotation that's come up in my teaching, and I'll share that with people, and then I'll write a couple very brief paragraphs, a couple short reflections, trying to show how that great insight makes a difference in our life. So I want it to be a kind of way that people, a lot of former students do it, a lot of people that never had the opportunity to get a liberal education, study philosophy, like to tune in and to just get little snippets. It's like a little drip mini course, week in and week out, kind of reminding us this wisdom is here, we can turn to it, and it will make our lives better.
And the site is beautiful. It's physically beautiful as well. As a matter of fact, you wrote on beauty today. And how much of being a true human, becoming myself, as you had put it earlier, is connected to not rushing all the time, not always being in these kind of artificial environments, like. I mean, not to say anything against McDonald's, but I mean, you know, this great sameness of the modern world. How much of that, getting out of that and being quieter and slower, is connected to living a fuller life?
Great. Again, you're raising the great issue, and I say it's very connected. And if I may kind of step back for a moment to say, it's exactly that kind of issue that these principles help us address. Do I stop at McDonald's? Of course. But frankly, if you said something against McDonald's, I'm not going to take issue with that. The so many of the contexts in our lives that we've started to take for granted are in varying degrees can have a dehumanizing effect upon us. And we, again, these principles, this ancient wisdom helps us see that. It helps us then be able to start to think about it. We don't have to be scared. One of the most common responses I get of people who read the blog is, it was so comforting to hear you say that or to explain that, because they'll say, I kind of knew that, or I had this intuition that that was the case, but then you took this great ancient thinker and you made it clear and you helped me understand why I've been thinking this, or why I have a problem that young people are not good at face contact and communicating because they're always on their phones and things like this. It's not about carping and complaining about problems, but we have to be realistic. Our life is being threatened in fundamental ways. We're not eating together with our families. Young people don't know how to look people in the eyes and communicate and empathize and stand in real and true relationships. There is no human happiness without real friendships. And the very possibility of friendship is becoming harder, and young people are being stripped of this by the banal context that they are put in, that are made to look all glittery and happy through media and so many other sources. So this is very serious stuff. We need to gird our loins and to think clearly. How are we going to act? There's no cookie cutter answer. But the point here is these basic principles give us the foundation to think clearly and to work together with our friends and families on these things.
That's a ringing, passionate endorsement of friendship in that critique of the dehumanizing effects of our contemporary world. What are we not getting about friendship? What are we missing?
You know what? I think one of the main things is we're missing the importance of character, the importance of how friendship is a matter of sharing deeper things together. The notion of friendship has been so banalized. Friends wants to share life together, but what is life? The notion of friendship always brings you back to the most fundamental issues. We just said the fundamental insight was about the good life from the ancients was that in virtue is happiness. Well, virtue then, you carry it right over to friendship. You can only stand in as good a relationship to another human being as you are striving to live virtuously. For Aristotle, true friendship, the deep, most important kind, there's other kinds too, but the deep, most important kind is in living virtuously, striving to be virtuous together, seeking these deeper things together. That's what unites people. The more banal the thing, these things don't unite us. They leave us empty. So friends need something richer.
888-318-7884, the number. Again, I am falling into that problem of monopolizing you. I really do. I must confess that it's a great privilege to have you here with us, but I have to go to callers. Otherwise, it's just mean and unfair.
No problem at all.
How about we go to John in Mount Vernon, Illinois, listening to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. John, your question for Dr. John Cutaback.
Hi, gentlemen. How are you this evening?
Very well, thank you.
Hi, great, thank you.
Great. I'm listening to the show, and I have a lot of respect for what's being discussed, but I'm getting confused. I will admit that I am a novice in formation for the permanent diaconate, and there's a lot of philosophy in our intellectual formation. And as I'm listening to the show, and particularly, you know, some of the ancient Greek philosophers that you're quoting, you know, it's very, very, very interesting. I'm glad to know that that, you know, many of their philosophies involve a deity and virtues. But I want to know that that the Catholic Church, which you know, I love to death, is the truth and not just another way of thinking.
Amen.
And when I hear so much ancient philosophy, somehow doubt creeps into me.
Well, I have a thought for you. I certainly think, well, I can understand that. I think if we look closer, we'll see that it absolutely should go the other direction. It certainly is the case. We can all be discouraged. The great philosophers point this out. Aristotle points out it can be discouraging when you see how much difference there is in how people think. And it can make you be tempted to become a relativist. Aristotle and Plato, to me, are though a great answer to relativism. While they understand that temptation, at the same time, they have absolute confidence. If we dispose ourselves well, we will be able to see the truth. Not that we'll see the whole truth. If Socrates insists, the more you come to see, the more you'll realize there's much more to see that you haven't seen yet. But there is an objective truth that they were highly aware was much deeper and greater than they had yet seen. And the way I really want to point out to you the beauty of how that fits good philosophy, because there's always going to be bad philosophy. Just the effects of sin in human life are dramatic. There's always going to be bad philosophy, but good philosophy points towards the truths of our faith. It points towards the fuller fulfillment of our deepest desires in a God who speaks to us and shows himself to us. I'll put it to you this way. For Aristotle, all the greatest philosophers saw we only come to real happiness when we're able to see the deepest truths, where we're able to somehow get in touch with the God from whom we've come. They had no notion that that God might reveal himself to us. They had no notion that that God might become man. But Christianity fits perfectly. They did not see that. So they are not Christian, and they fall short of Christianity. But I always like to think, and I think it's true, had they known that this God actually would come and speak to us and call us to an intimate relationship with himself, they would see that as the fulfillment of what they had seen. So we can't do much more now, but I just really want to give you the encouragement. The great St. Thomas Aquinas, the greatest theologian of the church, he saw the fundamental truths of philosophy, had absolute conviction that it stands with, undergirds Christianity, even while Christianity is the perfect fulfillment of that. The truth will set us free, and the truth is one, even if very deep and complex.
John, I want to go back to you. How does all that strike you?
I was just saying that 1 minute explanation soothed my soul. I'm back. You know,
good.
You just listen to it, and really, it sometimes it, what it really says is we all need further study, I think, or at least I do. And I just wanted to also make one comment on the friendship thing.
Okay.
I think friendships have become very surface kind of like friendships. Not really deep friendships anymore. We're not reliant on each other as a community anymore, even as our parents might have been in the 30s and 40s. I'm a 60-year-old man, so things have changed. You know, self-reliance is the new notion of the day.
Right.
And so I think
right.
friendships, you know, I mean, I can't tell you how many times I hear my kids and grandkids talking about their friends, and I find out that it's really just some Facebook friend that they've never met in their lives.
You know, what you're saying is very, very important, and it's central to the work that John Cutteback does. So I'm going to ask you to actually hang on through the break if you can, because I want to continue this very, very important conversation with our guest, professor and philosopher John Cutteback from Christendom College, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Have a question? We've got answers.
Catholic Answers
Live.
Hey everyone, Carlo Broussard here. Can you feel the heat? Summer is upon us. Things are heating up, my friends, and that includes our first ever summer book sale and the online shop at Catholic.com. For a limited time, we've got dozens of great books offered at $10, $5, even as low as $1 a copy. So you can load up on solid Catholic books for yourself, your friends, and your family. This spectacular online event offers saving of 50% and more on books by Jimmy Akin, Tim Staples, Rod Bennett, Gary Machuda, and a whole host of esteemed authors, evangelists, and apologists, including yours truly. We've even got all of the books in our Catholic Answers Classics series marked down. Log on now and all this month to the store at shop.catholic.com and take advantage of what will be one of the most exciting sales of the summer. You know it's all good stuff, because it's from the people you know and trust at Catholic Answers. Log on to shop.catholic.com and start saving today.
EWTN, helping people grow in their love and understanding of God.
I just wanted to thank you for your show. It's made such a huge difference in my faith life. Because if you don't know why you're doing things and you're just going through the motions, it's totally pointless. But if you know why, it's infinitely meaningful. So you really helped me make a 180.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Do you want to end abortion? Halt the attack on traditional marriage? And ensure religious freedom for ourselves and for our grandchildren? To do this, we must convert the culture. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a grassroots initiative that recognizes this need and takes it to the streets. If you're interested in peacefully sharing the gospel in your area, visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
John from Mount Vernon, Illinois, is on the line for John from Christendom College. And I have to tell you, John from Mount Vernon, thanks for hanging on. You're really, you're hitting the grace notes of John Cuddeback's philosophy, I have to say. But he's, when we went to the break, John from Mount Vernon was talking about the kind of shallowness, surfaciness of our relationships and our lack of a maybe felt need for community. You want to address those points?
I'm sorry, John, I'm sorry. Sorry, you're talking to me, John, or the other John?
Oh, yes, Dr. Cuddeback, if you could respond to that, yeah.
Sorry, absolutely.
No, it's all right.
And so one of the points that I love most is the way that Aristotle sees that happiness most of all is going to be in our having a certain character, but it's not in having that character alone. That ultimately human happiness is lived in friendships, which is this kind of very close, tight, small community, and then in the broader community also. We are profoundly social animals. And of course, this is just another instance of where the insight of natural reason fits so perfectly with divine revelation, of how there's that Trinitarian aspect to us of we're made for relationship. It's a very reflection of our being an image and likeness of God who lives this Trinitarian life. Our social character of human happiness is in living well together, living well together with your friends, with your loved ones. That is life at its height.
John from Mount Vernon, your last comment for us.
Yes, I love that. I think that if, you know, if we were more practiced and lived our lives in more of a virtuous way, and we appreciated what the Catholic Church was teaching with regard to some of these virtues, let's say the first, you know, the first and most important commandment, love, loving one another, caring for one another. People will hear that today and they'll say, oh, that's so idealistic. It's ridiculous. It's not going to happen. Well, only if we don't let it spread, you know, only if we are the few who, as you were saying, you know, gee, I think sometimes when you try to practice virtue, you might be persecuted. Yeah, that's true. But if more would do it, Just like you know, the divorce rate is up today. If more people practice not having sex before marriage, and they built that relationship on something more, something deeper, and they married, and then they had children, they had sex, they loved one another. You know, and then let's follow up with that. Don't commit adultery. Okay, so we don't wander. We're now in this happy relationship. It was built on something more than just superficial sex. And now we don't stray from that. This world would be different.
It would, John. Mm-hmm. It would. And I really appreciate your call. We're going to have to sign you up to be a guest on the show one of these days. I appreciate all that you've said. John Cuddeback, before I go back for other calls, any final thoughts for John from Mount Vernon?
I have a 10-second final thought for him, which is a thought for everybody. It's something I often say to my students, and I try to remember myself, and I say it from the bottom of my heart. I'm convinced that the truth of the matter is, the more we see the truth of reality, we will always find out that things are even better than we thought they were. And I'm saying that just as a word of encouragement to you. There's so many ways we can become discouraged, but the truth always ends up being better than we thought it was. Just a word of encouragement. We need to keep encouraging one another on that.
Again, John, thank you so much for that call. We go now to Claudia, listening on EWTN. Claudia, your question for Dr. John Cuddeback.
Thank you so much for having him. He's a genius, and I love him. And I want to be able to read your books, and so please let us know about your website. My question is this, since talking about that the truth will persevere and it's going to be, we would be successful as Christians by trying to make others see the truth, but it's so difficult. My question is, how can I help somebody that is pro-choice to, and he's not Christian, he doesn't believe in Jesus Christ. And he's an educator, but he is not using human reason. We have a conversation yesterday, very friendly, but the opposite. He's saying that the two cells, when they join together, they are not human cells. So how can you reconcile that the two points? He's not Christian. He doesn't believe in Jesus. If I talk about Jesus, he's not going to listen. And if I use human reason, he comes up that the two cells, the two gametos, are not humans. So how can you make them come to reason?
Okay, Claudia.
Yeah, Claudia, you ask a very important question. There's good news here, and there's also some hard news. But most fundamentally, it's good news. And the good news is, both reason and faith have the same answer. The light of natural reason is clear on this. I mean, frankly, his science is wrong. The science is very clear on, once conception has taken place, we have a human being. The more that science is able to study the zygote, the fertilized egg at conception, the more it just becomes clear from the simply scientific viewpoint that this is a human life. There's much that we can do beyond that, beyond just kind of focusing on the science, to talk about human dignity, to talk about natural law, to talk about the insights that we can all have into the difference, for instance, between humans and lower animals. There's so much to be said here. We're not going to be able to go through each aspect of what you would say, but here's my main, Claudia, this is my main suggestion for you. Just don't expect more of yourself than you can give. You could make a great argument and speak very clearly and eloquently, and there still is a very high chance that people will not have ears to hear. So don't put the burden upon yourself as having to have the perfect thing to say that will change people's hearts. God changes people's hearts. Let yourself be God's instrument. Put yourself in his hands and then think about what you might best say. My general recommendation is this: speak from the heart. Most people today are becoming less and less amenable to the rational arguments, as important as they are. It might sound funny for me to say this as a philosopher. I particularly encourage you, say, you can say things along these lines. Isn't it very clear the dignity of each human being that we see in our own experience? It's not dependent upon the age of the person. And you speak from the conviction of your heart. I think the thing that will most tend to move people, and again, it depends upon the person, is for you to speak with absolute confidence in what you have to say. Again, and don't hesitate to share your faith also, but it isn't, your conviction is not just rooted in your faith, Claudia, because it can be seen from natural reason. It can be seen from good philosophy. It can be seen from good science. So the hard news is people are becoming more and more deaf. It's going to be harder and harder to reach them. We put this in God's hands, and we pray, and we speak from the heart, and we speak with conviction. And this is all that we can offer.
Claudia.
Yes.
Okay.
I think that, yeah, thank you so much for the advice. I just feel that I planted the seed, and I think that all of us ought to talk and speak up, even though if we are in an environment that is hostile to us. I feel that I have been successful because we are afraid to talk about Christ or all these issues because we may be fired from work. I have taken the chance, and I want to encourage everybody to do it. I haven't been fired yet. They are still putting up with me. I keep talking and talking about this. So, yes, we need to talk.
God bless you. God bless you, Claudia.
Thank you so much, Claudia. It's inspiring. Before I left Claudia go, I wanted to get a clarification of when she said, "I love him and he's a genius," if she was talking about me or you. But I forgot to ask her. So I'll just.
I think I know which one, but I'm not going
to. I think she was talking about me, but I wasn't able to ask her. So
we'll go with that.
Claudia, thanks so much for that call. Dr. Cutterback, I hope we'll get to do this again. I want to remind people that if they want to connect to your effort as a philosopher to help people in the everyday struggle of modern life to live truly human lives, they can go to baconforacorns.com and sign up there for your Wednesday thoughts. They're brief. You don't have to feel that you're going to be getting some tome, but they're good. So you might wish they were a tome once you read them. That's right, baconforacorns.com. Am I correct in that?
From, but you got it. Bacon from acorns.
Oh, what did I say? Bacon for acorns?
They'll find it.
We're not going to feed the acorns bacon. That's not going to work. your students at Christendom College are blessed to have you. We've been blessed to have you. Will you do this again with us sometime?
I would sure love to. This has been a blessing for me, and I really appreciate it, Si.
Okay, so can you put it in one sentence for me, all the wisdom of the ancient world, so that I can leave with something in a nutshell?
Okay. Reality is an astounding gift, the beauty of which we will never fully comprehend.
Well, you did it. I'm so impressed. I thought I had assigned you an impossible task. Dr. John Cutterback, you can find him at baconforacorns.com or go take a class at Christendom College. I highly recommend it. Thanks so much for being with us today. Don't forget, hey, the big sale over at shop.catholic.com is just days from ending. Go to shop.catholic.com, get all kinds of cool stuff for just $1, $5, or $10, and $5 flat rate shipping on all of it. Tomorrow, 2 hours of open forum. Any question you've got on the life, the faith, the history of the Catholic Church will be welcome. God willing, we'll see you then on Catholic Answers Live. We'll be right back.